Coming up, a country in crisis, on the edge of a bubble. The economy crashed. Find out what could follow next today on 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. It should come as no shock for you to hear that America suffered through a great recession over the last few years. The economy, while still sputtering along, has somewhat recovered. But now, some are saying that a new recession is right around the corner, one that has far greater consequences than just economic. Take a look.
2007, the stock market closes at a record high. Home prices are up, and the unemployment rate is down. Yet within a few short years, it all falls apart. Stocks lose half their value, wiping out trillions of dollars overnight. Americans fall behind on mortgage payments, and 100,000 homes fall into foreclosure every month. The unemployment rate soon skyrockets, reaching double digits for the first time in 25 years. How did it happen, and happen so fast? A headline from the New York Times may have summed it up. Banks ignored signs of trouble. For years, the experts were dead wrong. They missed the warning signs, and the results were catastrophic. Now another institution is in the same spot that the economy was just a few years ago, and it too may be on the verge of collapse. In his new book, The Great Evangelical Recession, John Dickerson draws the parallel between the economy and the American church and says it's headed for a crash. The signs are there. The question is, will we heed them?
Well, joining us now via Skype is John Dickerson. His book, The Great Evangelical Recession, Six Factors That Will Crash the American Church, has been featured on the New York Times, the Washington Post, and CNN. John, welcome to our program.
Thank you, Gordon.
Well, for years, people have been talking about the waning numbers and influences of evangelicals in America. It used to be we were white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, and now that seems to be disappearing. You are saying in the book that it's even worse than what's being reported. Why is that?
You know, what it is where we are, but it's also the trends of where we're going. Much like with the economy, there were a handful of experts who saw the writing on the wall and said, this is the direction the economy is going. I actually remember as a journalist sitting in the office of a really wealthy real estate developer, owned hundreds of millions of dollars worth of property. And in 2006, he said, you know, John, if you have any property, you should sell it now because the entire economy is about to flip upside down. And it turns out he was correct. Well, in the American church, we actually have some voices that are saying the same thing. But what I found as a researcher is that these voices are all kind of separate and isolated. For example, some experts have documented very well that we're losing the majority of our children who grow up in the church, leave the church. Others have documented the financial decline. Others have documented how the culture is turning hostile towards us. What's unique about this book is that it draws all that research together so that you don't have to read 50 or 60 books. You can read this one and get a summary of all six of these negative trends and how they're affecting the American church.
You talk about our host culture, that it's turned so negative that it's at this point in time is actually hostile to the word evangelical. Why is that?
You know, what we're seeing is rapid cultural change. If you look at Gallup polls from the year 1996, as recently as 96, the vast majority of Americans opposed same-sex marriage. Well, if you look at the same poll, by the year 2001, that had flipped. The entire culture within 15 years reversed its position on an issue that for more than 200 years was set in stone. I mean, if you had taken a poll in the 1940s or 50s about same-sex marriage, you know, no one in America would have even thought you were serious asking about it. Well, within 15 years, we saw the entire culture flip-flop. So what we're seeing is rapid change, accelerating cultural change. And the evangelical church is not the only victim of this, but it's one of them. And what the book documents is that the culture is changing so rapidly that it used to be apathetic towards us. It used to just kind of tolerate us. Now it is becoming antagonistic and hostile. Let me give you two examples of this. One would be Chick-fil-A. If you remember last year, the national protests against Chick-fil-A for its owner, a Christian's personal, privately held religious views. And in cities like Boston and New York, you actually had mayors, publicly elected officials, saying, "Your business, your restaurant chain is no longer welcome in my city because of your privately held religious views." Well, you know, 10 years ago, that would have been unthinkable. We saw the same thing this year with the presidential inauguration when Pastor Louis Giglio was scheduled to pray there and essentially got pushed out. Why? Well, the guy's not homophobic. He's not hateful. He just 15 years ago in a sermon had said that, you know, the Bible says homosexual sex is a sin. And he, because he stated that biblical position, he's no longer welcome in the public square. This is the direction our culture's going.
It seems to be, and I agree with you, accelerating the cultural change. Literally, you blink, and it seems to change moment by moment. What are the drivers behind the acceleration of change?
You know, I believe, and a lot of secular sociologists believe, that it's technology. I mean, if you look at world history, all the way back to the Protestant Reformation, it was the printing press that accelerated cultural change. Then along came radio, and it accelerated cultural change. Cable TV accelerated cultural change. I believe the changes we're seeing are the result of 24/7 internet access all around the world. And, you know, accelerating cultural change in and of itself isn't good or bad. What it does is it takes the direction the culture was going and accelerates it in that direction. So with the Protestant Reformation, you had a very Christian culture, and the printing press broke loose a lot of great Christian things. Well, sadly, when we look at, you know, how is this new technology being used? Praise God for CBN and ministries that are using it for God's glory. Sadly, the vast majority of it is being used in hypersexual, hedonistic ways by our culture at large. And the culture seems to be rushing headlong into a hypersexual, self-centered, pleasure-centered, Sodom and Gomorrah type culture.
Well, one of the things we're observing at CBN, particularly in our worldwide broadcast, is that Christianity is growing at incredible rates overseas. When you look at the response rates coming out of Africa, even Muslim nations like Indonesia, the response rates, the number of new converts to Christianity, the church is literally exploding. When Latin America, Africa, Southeast Asia, Indonesia, it's incredible, the growth rates. Why is that happening? But at the same time, within the United States, it seems to be failing.
Praise God for that growth. And I'm so glad you mentioned it. You know, Jesus promised in Matthew chapter 16, he said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." So as followers of Christ, we take great refuge and comfort in that. When the books are closed on humanity, the church will have prevailed. Christ will have prevailed. But world history teaches us that as the church grows on other continents, it can shrink and decline in nations where it has once been strong. So for example, if we look at Scotland, England, and Germany, these countries used to be the Protestant capitals of the world. They started our first Bible seminaries and colleges, and they were sending missionaries all around the world. Well, now Christianity has waned so far in those countries. They've become so secular. In fact, there's such a religious vacuum in England now that where secularism cleared the path for a new religion to come in, now Islam is coming in. And in fact, the most common name for a newborn in England now is Mohammed. What we see with America is a very similar trajectory to England, where it was once a strong Christian nation, became very wealthy, and perhaps because we've become dependent on our wealth, our programs, our productions, our systems, we've lost our dependence on the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, and prayer. And as we've lost those raw spiritual values, and leaned on our human strengths, well, we've lost the spiritual power.
What do you think the solution is? I think you've identified the problem. But what do you think the solution is? I know for me personally, I have absolutely no faith in any kind of political solution. I just don't see that working. What do you think the solution is?
Yeah, the book documents, outlines from Scripture six solutions. And it's important to know these solutions aren't my opinion. They're not what we do at my ministry. They're all taken out of the Word of God. You know, living in a hypersexual, hostile culture is new to us, but it was the norm in the New Testament. So you look at books like 1 Peter, and God says to his people, hey, you are strangers and aliens in a hostile land. Don't be surprised when you're persecuted, but live such good lives that even if people accuse you of doing wrong, they see your Father and glorify him. So, you know, God's word has the answers we need. And I believe the first and most important answer is a humility. It's a humility for us and our leaders to get on our knees before the Lord and say, God, we admit we cannot do this in your strength. And God, we believe the same Holy Spirit who showed up in the book of Acts, who empowered 120 people to change the course of world history. Lord, we need that Holy Spirit here. And we thank you for our buildings and our funds and the things we have. But we're not depending on those, Father. We are humbling ourselves before you. And again, we want to be a church that is desperately dependent on you. That's the first of the six solutions.
John, well said. Thanks for being with us, and thanks for the book, and thanks for the wake-up call.
My privilege. Thank you for having me on.
Well, the book is called The Great Evangelical Recession, Six Factors That Will Crash the American Church and How to Prepare. It's available nationwide. If you want to weigh in on this discussion, all you have to do is go to our Facebook page. It's at facebook.com/700clubinteractive. And I'll weigh in that perhaps we could take a lesson from the Jewish people, how they avoided assimilation, how they maintain tradition, maintain the faith through centuries, thousands of years of living within hostile cultures. Well, coming up, a young man who wound up homeless and sleeping in a trash bag. Find out how a $10 bill changed his life. That's up next.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, ask yourself these three important questions. One, does your company not offer dental insurance? Two, are you self-employed? Three, are you retired? If you answered yes to any of these, it's important that you call Encore Dental today. Encore Dental is real insurance, and your acceptance is guaranteed. You'll receive up to 100% coverage for preventive care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures. Encore Dental can help keep your teeth healthy, which may prevent infections that lead to heart disease and stroke. And with the high cost of procedures, it makes sense to have great coverage. Choose your level of benefits. There are no claim forms to fill out and no waiting for reimbursement. So go ahead, review it for 30 days.
Call 1-800-671-6150. Call now and save an additional 10%.
Call now and save an additional 10%.
I'm so glad we could be here for Larry.
I was surprised to hear there was no life insurance.
Funerals are so expensive. I hope Larry can afford it.
I know. That's why I'm glad I got a policy through the Colonial Penn program.
Do you think they have coverage for me? Something that'll fit into my budget?
Yes. You can get permanent coverage for less than 35 cents a day. You won't have to take a physical or answer any health questions. Plus, your cost will never go up and your coverage will never go down.
If you're between 50 and 85, you can get guaranteed acceptance life insurance for less than 35 cents a day. There are no health questions or medical exam. You cannot be turned down because of your health. So call about the Colonial Penn program and ask one of their representatives about a plan that meets your needs.
I'm definitely going to call about the Colonial Penn program.
Call 1-800-219-1201 for free information and a free gift. Call now.
After his mother abandoned him, Matthew McFerrin felt as if he had loser written all over him. His life went from bad to worse. He ended up homeless and sleeping in a trash bag until he spotted a $10 bill on the ground.
I remember my first night on the street, and It was cold out that night. And I remember going to a playground and trying to huddle up in the jungle gym. I seen a trash can off in the distance. And I said, you know, it's probably a good idea to go take the liner from that trash can and sleep inside the plastic.
As a boy, Matthew McFerrin probably never thought he would end up like this, but he did. Matthew grew up near Youngstown, Ohio. He had a good relationship with his father, who was a firefighter and later a pastor, but he didn't share the same feelings toward his mother.
She would put me behind a door with Legos and just leave me there and not even talk to me. It really put me in a place where I thought that I was meant to be abandoned and rejected.
Eventually, his mother left. His father later remarried, and Matthew finally began to open up to his stepmother. But then she was diagnosed with a terminal illness.
I really took a selfish perspective where it was like, you know, I'm being abandoned again. And so it made those walls go right back up.
After losing a mother for the second time, Matthew, who was now in high school, turned to drugs to ease the pain.
I felt hurt. I felt lost. And I didn't know what to do. But I knew, you know, for me at that age, going to church didn't work for me. What worked was, you know, putting a haze in front of me so that I didn't have to deal with reality.
Matthew sold drugs as a teenager and then moved on to stealing cars.
One night I was at a party and I was getting drunk and there was a gentleman there that said, oh, you know, I have a buddy who runs a chop shop and they need a Nissan. And he said, they're gonna give $1,500 for the person that gets it. So that's like 3 weeks worth of selling dope.
After several years of stealing cars, he was arrested and sent to prison. For the first time in his life, his conscience started to bother him.
When I was in prison, I had a little bit of time to reflect and think about the things that I had done, the people that I had hurt, and it consumed me.
When he was released, Matthew decided he no longer wanted to steal cars. With no influx of cash, he looked for a cheap way to get high and found one, heroin.
3 months into shooting heroin, I found myself with nothing, broke and homeless. I had finally, you know, reached the place that I belong. Homeless, strung out on dope, sleeping in a trash can liner. And the plastic kept me warm, you know, but it smelled like trash. And I remember thinking to myself, you know, this is where you belong. This is what you deserve.
One evening, Matthew was out looking for his next fix.
I was walking northbound on 6th Avenue, and I start praying, saying, you know, Lord, please just give me $10 so I can buy a shot of dope. And I look off in the distance, and I see something that looks to be currency. About 10 yards, I could see a 10 on it. So I'm like, it's a $10 bill. You know, and I said, oh, there is a God. My whole life, I'm waiting for you to show yourself. And here you are right now giving me a $10 bill for dope.
The $10 bill was phony, but what was inside was worth far more.
I realized that it's not a real $10 bill. It's a fake $10 bill. And I said, you know, Lord, I knew you didn't love me. You know, I knew you weren't going to give me $10. And inside of it is the full book of Proverbs pulled out of those little miniature New Testaments. And I took that book of Proverbs with me that night. And I read that night about, you know, wisdom.
Matthew says that evening was a turning point in his life.
For the first time in my life, I remember thinking that there is a God and He is present in my life. I thought he had a warped sense of humor, you know. I would have preferred a real $10 bill. But this was one point where it was evident, you know, that the hand of God was working in this situation. And I felt the Lord saying that I'm always with you. I'm never going to abandon you. I'm never going to reject you.
He started going to church and studying the Bible, and later went through a successful recovery program. Soon afterward, he met and married Jennifer. Today, Matthew helps Jennifer run the Miracle Center in Tucson, a facility for women dealing with addiction. Matthew also hosts The Overcoming Life, a Christian radio show for recovering addicts.
It's one of the most powerful things about being a believer in Jesus Christ, about being a Christian, is we're given an opportunity to reach out into the darkness and offer people life. We're given an opportunity to reach out to people who are incapable of loving themselves and offering them an unconditional love that's so great that it can't be denied.
Matthew says his purpose in life is to use his experiences to share Christ with other addicts.
I know the creator of heaven and earth. I know the God that hung the stars in the sky, who knows the number of hairs on my head. What greater statement can be made? And if we truly believe that this is the God that we worship, how could we ever doubt that he's not going to work in our life?
He does number the hairs on your head. He does care very much for you. The entire gospel can be summed up with one word, love. For God so loved the world, that means you, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, again, that's you, whosoever, would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And here's God, caring so much for Matthew that he knew that prayer was going to happen. God, will you give me $10? That he placed a packet of information, the entire book of Proverbs, the wisdom of Solomon, right at Matthew's feet, so that he wouldn't perish, that his prayer would be answered, that he would know that God was reaching out to him, that he was coming just for him. And here's Matthew, down and out, homeless, strung out on drugs. And God reached down to say, I want you. I want you to be with me for all eternity. If you want to know him and know how powerful that relationship can be, how life-changing that is, to understand finally that God is love, and he loves you infinitely. If you want that, call us. It's a toll-free call, 888-777-1999. If you've been looking for purpose, for meaning, to understand that, yes, indeed, God answers prayer, God wants to come to you, he wants to reveal himself to you, call us. And there'll be a counselor on the other end of that line. I'll just say, I want to know, is Jesus real? Will he really come to me? I'd be glad to pray with you, glad to lead you into a wonderful relationship where you get to know him. Well, coming up, a new mom survives a tornado, but her home doesn't. Hear how she got a new one in just 3 days.
It's called fly ash.
This is in the back of the house, and you can see it's all over everywhere.
And it's the byproduct of burning coal.
Thousands and thousands of samples and in two studies that are public that there is no harm to human health.
It ate the roof off of my home. So if it did that, what is it doing to the insides of my body?
What both sides are saying in the debate over fly ash on the 700 Club next.
When you push furniture in, do bulky cables keep pushing it out? Then power it up with the Side Socket, the swiveling multi-plug miracle that allows you to move cords and furniture flush against the wall. Just plug in, pivot, and power up 6 different components. The unique swiveling action creates extra space where you need it most. Go ahead, push back couches, chairs, and more to make every room bigger than before. Finally, move kitchen appliances against the wall, increasing counter space. And it's the perfect and safe way to reroute power away from sinks with ease. Side Socket is even equipped with optional anti-surge protection to protect expensive electronics. Call now to get your Side Socket for just $10. But wait, we'll include another Side Socket free. Just pay separate processing and handling. That's 2 Side Sockets, all for just $10.
To order Side Socket for $10 plus processing and handling, call 1-800-901-3952. That's 1-800-901-3952. Order online at sidesocket.com.
A couple wants to start a family.
It was probably 9 years after we started trying. We were tired.
And almost gives up.
The breakthrough was when I kind of threw up my hands and said, you know, this isn't about me.
Hear how letting go of their dream led to a double miracle. Next week on 700 Club Interactive. One year ago, a tornado touched down in Harrisburg, Illinois, leaving nearly 300 families homeless, including one young mother who was about to give birth.
Like any new mom, Amanda Hedrick looked forward to bringing her new son home from the hospital. The problem was, she didn't have a home. Just days before her baby was born, an EF4 tornado ripped through Harrisburg, Illinois. She and her 10-year-old daughter were terrified.
I thought it was just the worst thing in the world. My whole neighborhood was gone. All you seen was flashlights and people screaming, help us, help us, help us. I couldn't imagine going through anything like that ever again. It was the scariest thing I've ever been through.
While she was in the hospital, her aunt found a mobile home for the young mom to rent. But it was dirty and in desperate need of repair. Operation Blessing was on the ground in the ravaged town. Amanda's aunt asked them for help with basic needs like cleaning and paint, maybe some new carpet. Instead of providing just basic repairs, Operation Blessing completely made over the home, installing new linoleum and providing appliances and furniture. We also designed a brand new nursery, already filled with clothes for the new baby. There's a room for her daughter, and of course, a beautiful bedroom for Amanda.
It's just beautiful in here. I never expected anything like this. Nothing at all. I couldn't ask for anything more.
But Operation Blessing had one more gift. The volunteers collected enough money to pay her rent for almost a year.
This is such a blessing. It is such a blessing to me. I don't know where to begin to thank everybody or to show my appreciation, but I promise if it's the last thing I do, one day, someday, somehow, I will let everybody know how thankful I am, and I will help somebody else just like you guys helped me.
One of the best things to do is to help other people, to love them. That's the great commandment, is to love one another. Love God, love one another, do good to people. And that's what we want to do here. We want to show what Christianity really is. It's loving other people. And loving them in very tangible ways so that when they're down and out, when they're hopeless, you can give them more than just a hand up. Give them a hand out. Give them a hand up. Give them a hope and a future to let them know that God loves them. We love them. And that it's just wonderful when you're able to do that. You can do that right from your home and just say, yeah, I want to help. I want to be a part of everything. By joining the 700 Club. A portion of every gift you give goes into the work of CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. Another portion goes into the work of Operation Blessing to help people and help them in very tangible ways. So if that's you, if that's what you want to do, call us right now. It's toll free, 888-777-1999. Just say, yes, I want to join the 700 Club. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. There are no checks to write. And you're confident that your gift is coming in every single month. We save so much on the processing, we can send as our gift back to you, Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. So if you like those, ask for Pledge Express when you call. Do it now, 888-777-1999. Well, this is 700 Club Interactive, and today's guest has prompted a bunch of chat questions. So let's go to Marguerite in the chat room.
Yes, Gordon, this is from Josiah. I live in a small town and my church has been around for decades, but many of the families here have been members for years too, but we don't have very many young faces. Now the leaders are planning all of these new changes for the worship and sanctuary to bring new people in, and a lot of the members are anxious. Some are talking about leaving altogether. What should we do?
Boy, Josiah, your story is a story across the nation, and I've seen this story lead to church splits, people upset that, we're having new songs that go up on overhead, church splits over do we have drums in worship or not. Here's a change that I think will change the entire complexion of Christianity in America. Focus on discipleship and not just, training in terms of what is biblical theology, but focus on taking people, making them disciplers of other people so that on a generational basis, you're not just creating people that inhabit a pew, but people who go out and try to change their community. If we do that, we can change America. We leave you this word from Numbers chapter 6. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace.